Hello, everyone. I want to welcome you to Hermeneutics331.ro. My name is Jency Acosta, and I'm your professor for this class. I finally decided to create a video for you guys as we are transitioning from the hermeneutics of the first century, and then with our book that we're going to be covering for the rest of the semester, Is There Meaning in This Text, by Kevin Van Heuser, looking more at issues that deal with hermeneutics at large. And what I mean by that is the hermeneutical conversations that are happening in society at large. There are conversations happening, not just at Nyack College or Christian colleges, but in universities and colleges throughout the world, and it involves the very topic of the title of the book that we're going to be reading. But I thought it was important, and I think that it is vital for us to take a moment to stop and to consider the things that we've learned, the things that we have considered in order to be ready to move forward to the next phase of our class. You guys have already learned through Richard Longnecker's book and two chapters that you guys have read from his book about the exegesis and the hermeneutics of the first century. You guys have been able to read through the rules of a rabbi named Hillel, a rabbi that predates the days of Jesus. The reason that I had you read that section is because throughout the New Testament, the rules of Hillel are often implemented within the text that you read in the New Testament. And we simply don't even realize that that's happening. Many people who study the New Testament are completely oblivious to the fact that many of the rules of hermeneutics that are employed in the New Testament are actually rules that were used, and it makes sense, in the Jewish community. And I believe that there's a disconnect in understanding because we limit our education. And we do not peer into the Jewish resources that we have. I believe that there's a limitation that pastors and even professors have when they don't peer into that world to discover what may be going on in the New Testament. I want to give you an example of that. You guys had already an assignment where you guys were able to pull out texts in the Bible and line them up with the Midot, or the rules of Hillel. And I'm just gonna use one. And the one that I'm gonna use is Hillel's rule that is basically transliterated this way, Binyan Ab Mikatov Echad. And that means building up a family from a single text. When the same phrase is found in a number of passages, then a consideration found in one of them applies to them all. Now, I think that it is important to note that whenever Jesus is stopped and he is asked, Lord, which is the greatest commandment? And Jesus replies, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Then he does something interesting. He says, and the second one is just like it, and love your neighbor as yourself. I think it is fascinating to know that the first portion of Jesus' answer is found in Deuteronomy. Actually, it's found in Deuteronomy, the sixth chapter. But the second part of Jesus' answer, you would imagine, would come the next verse down, or maybe a few chapters later in Deuteronomy, but it shows up in a completely different book. It shows up in Leviticus. And it's really interesting to consider that, because whenever you're taking a look at the New Testament and taking a look at what Jesus is doing, it really does seem like they're sequential. This is the first, the greatest commandment, and then the second one is just like it. But Jesus is using this rule of Hillel, this binyan ab mikatov echad. He's using this with a very rare phrase in the Bible in general, and it is the phrase ve'ahavta. Ve'ahavta in Hebrew means, when you translate it, it means, and you shall love, and you shall love. But this rare form of the word love, with the vav in front, which is a character in Hebrew, ve'ahavta, and you, and it is speaking about the second person, and you shall love. This rare form of the verb love is found just a couple of times throughout all of the Old Testament. And what Jesus does is he uses this rule of Hillel to take two passages that otherwise would be completely unrelated and magnetize them together. And what Jesus is doing is saying, you see that term and that commandment to love the Lord your God, the second one that has this very rare form, it's just like it. And what Jesus was able to do is that he was able to expound an entire theology with verses that are completely unrelated, magnetize them together using one of the rules of Hillel. And it astonishes Jesus' audience. Because to be able to know the rarity of that form would have been an indication of how well Jesus would have known the entire Bible. One would have had to have known that that phrase shows up so rarely that you can magnetize them together and it would be a significant statement, not just a statement that could be made at any turn of a book or any chapter, but it is a significant statement that Jesus is making. And the scribes, those in his audience, would have been blown away at the accuracy with which Jesus is able to use this rule of Hillel. Actually, whenever you take a look at Jesus' phrases and the way that he's handling the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible, it is in a very sophisticated way. In comparison to Paul, it blows Paul the Apostle out of the water. And I think it is a sign of the divinity of Jesus. At the very least, it is a sign of his brilliance. But Jesus, in comparison, what he does in a verse or two takes Paul books to write. You guys now have some of this information, and you guys now have the ability to take a look at the New Testament and see how the authors of the New Testament, Jesus himself, Paul the Apostle, among others, are utilizing the Hebrew Bible and using these rules to interpret the Bible. I wanted to go ahead and define a couple of terms just briefly, and I'm just going to toss them in here because if we were in a classroom together, I would have talked about it, and it is important for you guys to understand what exegesis as opposed to eisegesis means. I remember being in hermeneutics here at Nyack College whenever I was a student here, and hearing the term, and I just remember thinking it was funny because it just sounded like Jesus. But exegesis is what we would consider the proper way of interpreting a text. And the reason that it's proper is because you've done the historical background, you've handled the language as best you can, you've been able to read it, considering its genre, whether it is narrative or whether it's poetry or what have you. And you've been able to, as best as possible, with all the research, with the language, and also with your knowledge of what genre it is, you're able to take a look at this text and say, this is as close as possible what I can see that the author is trying to communicate. You know, it's interesting because at the end of the day, Richard Longnecker came to this conclusion in chapter 8 of his book that the historical grammatical method is the method that he believes can get us closest to understanding the text of the Bible. And so we had a discussion on our discussion board that basically asked, you know, is Richard Longnecker saying that copying or going back to the first century hermeneutics is obsolete and that we shouldn't do that? Is there any benefit? And at the end of the day, I believe that there is so much benefit to going back and understanding rules like the rules of Hillel and understanding how Paul and Jesus did or interpreted texts. And the reason I think that it is so key and so vital to do so is because unless you understand those rules, then even when you're looking at it historically, you won't understand the reason why Jesus would bring together these two texts, for example. Why would Jesus pull out this text in Leviticus and then this text in Deuteronomy? What is the significance of that? You just wouldn't know. You wouldn't understand. And so I think that even if the historical grammatical method is a method that we choose to go ahead and understand, within the historical aspect of investigating the text, it would behoove us to understand the rules that they are engaging in hermeneutically. And I believe what his point was is that we shouldn't say any longer, hey, you know, this text in the Old Testament, you know, or in the Hebrew Bible, that means, you know, like America's going to house the beasts in Revelation. In other words, we shouldn't make these kinds of statements jumping from a text in the Bible, interpreting it and saying, this is the word of God. What Richard Longnecker is trying to communicate is that the apostles had a special task to reveal, to communicate the revelation of Christ in a special way because they were with him. And with Christ and the apostles, with those that were found in the first century, the providence of God made it in such a way that they would be the people that would be handing to us texts that we would hold sacred also. And so what he's communicating is that some of those things have closed as that generation came to a close. But I don't think he's suggesting that we shouldn't understand how exactly they operated. And I would encourage you to remember the rules of Hillel whenever you're considering text, to yes, take seriously the historical grammatical method whenever you're writing your papers, that would help. For those of you that will be writing the traditional papers, meaning you're choosing a text and you are basically taking what you've learned in this class to write a research paper, if you're going to be doing that, you're going to be relying heavily on the historical grammatical method. I want to contrast that from the historical critical method, which is a method that came to be and rose in the 17th century, but came into popularity in the 19th and 20th centuries. And the historical critical method concerned itself more with kind of like the source of the text that we read. In other words, how did the actual pages of Matthew come together? Who wrote them? Who compiled them? What was the original audience? And it concerned itself more with source theory than it concerned itself with what the author intended in writing what was written. So it's almost like, you know, and I believe the analogy of a mirror is used by Kevin Van Heuser in the text that we're going to be reading for this week, but it's almost like taking a mirror, and one is concerned, you know, one field is concerned with how do you actually assemble this mirror together, right? And the other one is concerned with looking at the reflection of the mirror. There is two different fields. It's two different methods. There's two different goals. One is concerned with how do you actually assemble and create the thing. The other one is concerned with the actual use of the thing and what it was intended to be. And so many conservative scholars have basically been just kind of exhausted by all of the things that the historical critical method concerns itself with. However, because those who are conservative scholars really do care about the message that the Bible is portraying, they concern themselves more with the historical grammatical method because they want to know what Paul was trying to communicate or what Jesus was communicating, what he spoke. And so we in this class will be using the historical grammatical method if we're doing a traditional paper. But I want you guys also to incorporate some of the things that we're going to be learning in the next few weeks. And if you choose to do the traditional paper, I want you guys to be able to bring into conversation some of the topics of hermeneutics at large. Topics like postmodernity and deconstruction, and how this text and what you're communicating will sound in a postmodern relativistic society. We'll learn and delve a little bit more into that in future weeks. So, we learned the hermeneutics of Jesus. We learned the hermeneutics of the first century. And I'm going to tell you by that, and by virtue of that alone, you have already gotten the bang for your buck. Many of the hermeneutic classes, I mean, I've been studying biblical studies for at least 8 years, and I've taken hermeneutics at least once or twice at NIAC and in other schools. And in those hermeneutics classes, we've never covered the hermeneutics of Jesus. And so that's yours. You're welcome. God bless you. Okay, so, but now that we know this, we're going to be doing a drastic shift this week. And we're going to be delving into Kevin Van Heuser's Is There Meaning in This Text? And Kevin Van Heuser, I just want to just state this and align with you. He graduated from Cambridge, and his vocabulary is exemplary. I want you guys to struggle with this text. I want you guys to have a dictionary nearby. I want you guys to keep a journal. This is a NIAC journal that I have, you know. I want you guys to write down words that you guys don't understand. In particular this week, you're going to be learning about deconstruction and undoers and perhaps the term users and stuff like that, terms that Kevin Van Heezer is going to be using throughout the rest of this book. And it would be so helpful if right from the beginning you begin to take notes and you guys begin to define terms. And I know you have to, you know, just kind of take that humble pill and just kind of own it, but at the end of the day, it's going to be so worth it. And I'm here to coach you through what the rest of the semester is going to be like. So don't get discouraged. It's going to be a lot of reading. It's going to be tough. It's going to be dense. But at the end of the day, it is going to be worth it. In this book, we're going to be discussing how we can make claims like, this is true because the Bible tells me so, but do it in a society that doesn't believe in capital T truth, that doesn't believe that God is able to communicate to us, much less that we are able to communicate effectively as authors to readers. And we're going to be bringing into this class conversations that are happening at large in universities throughout the world, so that we're not in our own bubble. I think that it is our responsibility, if we are to take this message and communicate it effectively to our neighbors, to those overseas, to those around us, to those in the workplace, for us to be able to understand what is being discussed where our coworkers are going to school for, and the colleges that they choose to go to, and what perhaps are going through people's heads whenever they sit down on a Sunday for the first time and you are simply proclaiming truths that are coming from God, and they're looking at you like, is this guy serious? I want to encourage you, because it's going to be challenging, and it's going to require a lot from you. And sometimes it's going to require faith, and it's going to require patience, and you're going to feel like you're not able to make it through the chapter. I want to give you guys, I want to suggest you guys give yourselves a lot of time to read the chapter, maybe reread it if you can. Take your time, read through it, keep fighting. Because at the end of the day, the things that we're going to be discussing in this class is going to train you not just to be able to read Jesus and Paul better, but then to be able to take what you've learned about how to read Jesus and Paul and be able to bring that to a society that is so disconnected from this world. I know many of you guys are concerned for your grades. You guys want to get A's in this class. And I think that that is valid. I went to graduate school when I graduated from Nye College. I went to Princeton Seminary, which is a top tier seminary, and got a master's degree there, and so I know how important grades are, and so fight for those grades and do your work and challenge yourselves. But more than that, more than just being an A student, my biggest responsibility isn't, and my biggest concern isn't, that you get an A in this class, but that you're witnesses. And so, I did this little video to encourage you. Stay in it. Don't be discouraged. God is with you. Write to me if you need any help, if you have any questions. I'm so blessed that you guys are here with me. I'm so excited for this adventure. God bless you. Signing off.